invited to me, and it's our pleasure to welcome Sami Khatib to join us today at the first public appearance of this joint research trajectory, which happened out of shared interest in translation from diverse angles, which is philosophy, also translation into language as a practice, and translation also as a metaphor, and coming from two perspectives. We are both contemporary curators, coming from two different research interests. We delve into different ways and deal with translation. This research project doesn't have a given structure and or a very clear format, but it starts out of salon readings, public talks, studio visits, and meeting with people who share this interest from many different angles. And these sessions take place in public or sometimes private places, mostly in Amsterdam. Of course, for us, the translation trip is an encounter of these two researchers, which also takes translation as an aesthetic but also as a political device, as its core center of inquiry. And we are looking at language as a force that allows hegemony and also function as a colonial force. And of course, in our life, especially also in our profession, translation has an ever-present is ever-present. And also, when you think of exhibition making, then dislocation and relocation and or displacement are terms we are dealing on an everyday basis. And so these mechanisms pushed us towards engaging with these political and aesthetical implications in a larger perspective. As Benjamin says in his essay on the task of the translation, translation is a mode. And for us, translation is not only translating from one language to another, but we think of it also as translating a thought into a verbal expression, and this verbal expression into writing. And of course, in contemporary visual art, there is also writing becoming, or verbal expression becoming more and more important. That's why, for instance, from my perspective, I look into the usage of English, somehow I felt in my research trajectory a pressing lack to talk about the hegemony of this language, and to delve into grey areas of language, or to see parts where sort of change in language, what kind of voices it allows to be heard.
Yeah, and I also would like to introduce a few concepts that are related to my own research and what we've been discussing with Kris, but it's also like a kind of introduction to the reading, to the close reading that Sami will do with us, and also like an introduction about our precise interest in this text by Walter Benjamin, and the reason why we chose this text as a starting point, public starting point for the project. So like operating within relations and power relations, translation seems to have two different sides. It can be the means of violation or erasure of the other's voice. What we see, for instance, in the hegemonic use of English, of standard English today, as Kris was saying. Or instead, translation can also trigger transformation. And as Benjamin posits, translation can be the embracement of strangeness. Translation can be the fulfillment of the colonial, colonizing, hegemonic character of language as such, and also of language in specific historical and political occurrences, but can also mean the liberation of language from its colonial vest. This duality, for instance, emerges quite clearly from what Edouard Glissant wrote on the dynamics and poetics of relation between alterities, but also between our own different selves. On the one hand, Glissant claims the right to be opaque, to resist translation, somehow the right to remain untranslatable. But on the other hand, is also known as being like one of the greatest theorists of creolization, which is a linguistic and cultural phenomenon where translation becomes, for the oppressed, the means of resistance, survival, invention, liberation. So it's like it's a subversive art, in fact. Within this horizon, the importance and relevance of Benjamin's text is, according to us, the deep and unique philosophical take on translation as a political, historical, and aesthetic form. In particular, we have invited Sami Khatib to debate with us on some key passages of the essay, also against the backdrop of Benjamin's other writings on language and history. The main point we will discuss is the function, the process, the labor of translation as the never-achieved tension of history towards the liberation of language from the duty of transmitting sense, information and meaning, so to uplift language from its colonizing force and canonizing power and set it free as a pure language where semiosis, which is like signification, does not take place anymore. And Sami will also tell us how this is like a central part of Benjamin's idea of a messianic end, like in his overall philosophy. So Benjamin recognizes in translation the work of history itself, and in the task of the translator, that of the historical materialist, the philosopher, who liberates a language which is imprisoned or encapsulated in a form of signification through his own recreation of the work. And Benjamin uses like the word recreation to designate the work of the translator. And this recreation perhaps can also offer us a lead towards a kind of aesthetic of translation, or at least it offers us like a link between translation and art practice. He says, and I'm quoting here, "Translation extinguishes meaning in favor of the expressionless and creative word." And it seems to me that there is a clear resonance between this sense of translation and also the purpose of art as it's emerged in like in the Breton and Slovakian tradition of estrangement. So like the removal of objects and language from the sphere of mere recognition, communication and signification. And I'm just wondering whether isn't this like the ultimate function of art and poetry, that of liberating objects and words from the continuum of transmission and also to lay bare the convention and the codified rhetorics of power of authorities and of the language of the market even. So with these questions, I would like to then like give the word to Sami.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me and having me. Thank you, Kris, and thank you, Sara. What I'm going to do is basically giving you a short introduction, and you really look that this is short, otherwise I talk too long. Short introduction into the text and where it stands in Benjamin's thought and oeuvre, and then just sharing with you certain notes or how I develop my own close reading. So it's basically, I would probably need the help of you. Someone will read out the yellow pages. I can't see them because my computer is over there. And we just discuss them together. And that should be the second half of it. And I can already say that the problem of the essay is in the details. So all what you hear now in kind of a general introduction, you can, it's a mere orientation, and you have to immediately forget it and correct it with the text together with me. So I will just say something about the task of the translator. Of course, I'm speaking English now, but I was raised in the German language, so I will just briefly mention the German title, Die Aufgabe des Übersetzers. So you already have one of the notorious German puns and also ambiguities in the very title. We should remember that Benjamin wrote that essay as an introduction to translation that he tried to do. That was the translation of Baudelaire. And Baudelaire is also one of the notoriously untranslatable authors in French literature. And at Benjamin's time, there was already an existing one, a really good one, of Stefan George. The circle around Stefan George, more let's say, elitist conservative circle of poets and the theorist can be seen as a kind of a counter project to what Benjamin was up to in the early 1920s. So, 1923, the essay appeared, was published as a preface to this collection of translations. And the Aufgabe des Übersetzers could also be translated as not only the task, but also Aufgabe as surrender. That's also Aufgabe, aufgeben, giving away, giving up. That's the same German word, Aufgabe. So you can even say that the task of the translator is also the surrender of the translator insofar as he or she submits herself or himself to language, but also it is kind of a surrender vis-a-vis the untranslatability of certain phrases, of certain parts in the to-be-translated text. So in a way, it's kind of ironical that Benjamin chose this title, given the task he was dealing with, and he almost got mad with Baudelaire, that because Baudelaire was just too complicated to be translated, and still today, actually, Benjamin's translation is not considered as the best translation of Baudelaire. Parisian, in German, it's still the Stefan George one. Nevertheless, during his failure, while failing and trying always again, he gave us a very interesting theory of language and a very interesting theory of translation. Within his thought, you can say that the Aufgabe des Übersetzers is in the middle, or in the early middle part of his theory of language. It already starts in 1916 with another really dense and enigmatic essay. We might go into detail of this essay briefly later. It's called On Language as Such and the Language of Man. This doubling, language as such and language of man, is already quite interesting for us. We will maybe refer to this later. That was 1916, now we are in 1921. And then later, in 1933, there are two other kind of strange fragments, a mimetic faculty on the doctrine of the similar, which is his later more materialistic theory of language. So we are in the middle. And in 1921, we should also keep in mind that he was developing the theory of politics, or like his first political, explicit political writings, as a reflection of the failed German Revolution after the First World War. And somehow we will see that there is an inner relation between the famous essay that was of 1921, which is a critique of violence, and the other, slightly later written, Aufgabe des Übersetzers, task of the translator. I will also refer to this in detail later. So this is basically to map where Benjamin is. He was born in 1892, so this is 21, he was still quite young. And it is also before he turned to be a Marxist or aligned his political practice with communism. That was in the mid-20s, so this is 1921, 22, basically. Yeah, we could already start with the first slide, basically, with it's the beginning of the essay. No poem is intended for the reader, no picture for the beholder, no symphony for the listener. And I took this as a motto to allude what I would call Benjamin's anti-pedagogical stance towards translation and also towards literature and philosophy and art in general. So what we have here is a decentering of the human. It's not the anthropos is in the center of translation, in the center of language. Language does not serve any target audience. Language is not in the service of communication, and also art doesn't serve anyone, and especially not the recipient or the beholder. Rather, it stands for itself. And the whole theory is about immediacy, not immediacy, but the immediacy or the medium of these very works, their linguistic medium, and how we share that. Mitteilen, Mitteilbarkeit, so impartibility. The impartibility of the language of works of art, of language as such, and so on. So it is not that there are humans who use or develop or invent language instrumentally in order to communicate or to share something. Rather, there is language, and we are thrown into language. Language, we are the animal that language has been given to, as he has in this slightly theological recounting of the myth of Genesis and Moses 1 and the Bible. So it is basically a very anti-communicative theory of language, which goes totally against the grain of everything we know from communication studies, from the communicative turn of critical theory, as most prominently pronounced by Habermas. So this is really something where we have to take the human outside of language first and look at language and how language relates to itself and how we can impart language, how we can be part of that. So the starting point maybe sounds strangely familiar if one is familiar with certain strands in theology, especially in Kabbalistic theology, Judaism, and also in Gnostic Christian theology. So the question would be, what is imparted, mitgeteilt, or shared in language other than the imparted message, information, or content, mitteilung? So already this sounds kind of weird. What is being imparted other than the imparted itself? What is there in language other than the content, other than the message, other than the information? So obviously he's looking for the medium itself, the medium of language. So the linguistic mediacy of language, that is what is essentially imparted by language. Imparted, shared, mitgeteilt. And that is why one should really refrain from translating mitteilung or mitteilen as communication. With communication you already have a different, structure of thought that thinks of language as an instrumental tool of transferring one meaning from here to there. So the mystical question is, what is in language other than the content of it? And of course it has a long history in terms of that God's word or some kind of dignity of language is being imparted in language, which might be the echo of the creation of God or some other, let's say, supernatural being what is in language, which imparts itself in language, in the very content, but it is not identical with the content, the information of language. This would be the first thought. But then Benjamin is rather anti-mysticist, because there is nothing to be revealed. There is no deeper knowledge once this medium is being staged. So what we learn about the linguistic meaning of language, what is language other than its content, other than what is being communicated, other than its information, is no secret. There is no secret to be revealed. It is basically the staging, the Darstellung, the performance, the exhibition of its very immediacy. And already this sounds kind of tautological, and the whole, let's say, task of translating, Benjamin's task of the translator into colloquial speech will be to make sense of this almost seemingly tautological argument. What is being transmitted, imparted in language other than the imparted, other than the information, and why this is no secret, why this is basically the mediacy of language itself. And in philosophical terms, you can already see this is a big claim. That is, the mediacy is basically Benjamin's counter concept, the Mitteilbarkeit in German, the ability to impart. This is a different concept, you could also say medium. It's a different concept than the competing other philosophical solution you have for this, which would be the Hegelian term of Vermittlung, mediation. Of course, this is a very vulgar reading now of Hegel, what I would say, but in the vulgar sense, you could say We have here the philosophical choice between two entities, this is not Hegel but Hegelianism again, two entities being mediated, vermittelt, externally. Something is in the middle and gives the bridge, the medium to something what is here and there. This is one philosophical choice. And the counter choice or the other proposal that Benjamin is making is what is the medium, the mediacy that encompasses this and that. In a way, the mediacy, the medium, is a priori, is pre-existent, is transcendental for the very content and for the very positions that can be articulated in this medium. So, medium is not something in interspace between A and B, or between one word and another, or between one language and another language, but it is the very space that in the first place gives us the position of a speaker, the place of a language, and the very interrelationality of languages. So the medium is transcendental. That is why there is nothing to be mediated. It is already, always already in the medium. And that would be Benjamin's, let's say, other philosophical choice against mediation, against vermittlung. So this was a long introduction already in the whole project of Benjamin. Again, with this highlighted passage, the human does not stand in the center of language. It's an anti-humanism of language. And every theological allusion you will find in this essay, also in the earlier essay, always when there is divine language or pure language, or the origin of language is not to be sought in empirical human history, but it is, you know, given to us by God. Always when you see that, you can see this is Benjamin's, you can say, stand-in concept to say this is anti-humanism. We are not the originators, neither of language, nor of any messages in language, nor the authors, as authors, we are not the origin of a work of art, even if we empirically have done it. It's all in the medium of language, it's all in the medium of their very own mediacy, and what we do, we take part in it. But we can never monopolize it. It is never something that we could colonize in a total way. So this already gives us a hint towards the political implications of it. So Benjamin thinks that all expressions of life, as Lebens, can be related to what he calls das Lebendige, the living. And in the same relation, you can say that all works of art, but all works of literature, but definitely all works or artifacts of humans, as original, as produced by an author, can be rendered in their afterlife in a translation. That is their survival. So you have a double pairing. You have on the one hand all expressions of life, which you think are in the medium of language anyways, even if there are at first sight non-verbal, non-linguistic, non-semiotic signs, but he thinks they are all expressions of life are in language, and when they are in language, they have a history. And this history of language, of all expressions of life, gives rise to the concept of the living. This is what lives in it. And the living is something that also comes up in the essay on critical violence. The living is basically this, you can say, the supernatural properties of life, where life is distinguished from what Agamben with Benjamin called bare life. The organic life, the physical existence of us, which can be rendered by the state, which can be, which is basically the subject matter produced by any biopower. By the stage, what we are as empirical being, how we are rendered through the state by capital and so on, our organic, physical, psycho-sociological existence. This is life, and all the expressions of this life they bear witness to what he calls the living. And the living is not some eternal soul or some astral body or some esoteric being. No, it is basically everything that is being expressed by life, in of life, in language, which has history. That is what is the living. So the living, das Lebendige, is always in translation. That means every work of art, every work of literature, everything I say, the living of it, the Lebendige, is in its afterlife. And its afterlife, that means something which surpasses the very existence of the very utterance in time, in history, is translation. So, his whole point is that translation is something which is before any empirical translation already a possibility. He says ability. Something that can already is already be there as a potentiality, so to speak, a potentiality with a reality. So it is a potentiality that something can be translated as an expression of life into its translation, as, you know, manifesting or bearing witness to what he calls the living. So it's very important to not mix up, on the one hand, there is life or bare life and all expressions of life, which are in the here and now, can be governed, can be colonized, are subject to whatever power here, and what remains of them in history, in language. And this is basically the living. The living is at the same time das Lebendige and das Überleben, the survival. So the survival in history is precisely what remains of the life in history. And the very mode that this can be transformed and can stay in all its transformation is translation, translatability. So it's a very, very broad concept of language, a very, very broad concept of translation. And basically what I will do in the next, you cut me down, in 20 minutes is basically to repeat this in all possible ways I can express this. It's always the same argument. So again, I will try another take on it would be, if I say translatability is not about a content, it's not about an information, it's not about what is being imparted, but about the very medium of impartability as such. This is also the medium of the living. There, the work of art or any utterance will live on, but it surpasses, survives itself. But then I have also said that translation cannot be deduced from a phenomenological or prima facie similarity, like same phonemes, same vowels, or even scripture looks similar, or, you know, you can easily say this about Germanic languages, especially if you look at certain vocabulary in the English, the Dutch and the German, probably Danish and Norwegian should be added here. So this would be superficial similarities that you can draw, but Benjamin has another thesis. He thinks that all languages are transcendentally, so before any empirical language is being spoken and developed, has become into history, are related or verwandt, they share a kinship. And this will be basically the end of the introduction, how we can relate strangeness of languages to their kinship. So again, all languages are, before any empirical language has been spoken, are verwandt. They are related, interrelated, they share a kinship. This kinship is not empirical similarity, which could be a kind of a phenomenology of any language that can be rendered in signification. No, they are already before related, interrelated. And the translatability of language is just basically the proof that they are all interrelated before any empirical language has been spoken. The starting point of translation is the translatability. So the very unique and singular, untranslatable modes of expression in every language. And they, all together as an integral, give rise to what he calls translatability. So again, it's singularity and untranslatability as the starting point, the base from where he develops a universal theory of language and a theory of universal translatability. And universal translatability before any empirical translation has been taken place. Only from this very counterintuitive mode, again, taking untranslatability as a starting point of translation, towards universal translatability, he can say there are works of art, works of literature, which are translatable inherently in their very quality before any empirical translation had been taken. So it is something which is pretty against the common logic, because we would say, yeah, you know, there's a certain thing that is lost in translation. For Benjamin, there is never ever anything lost in translation. So what could be lost in translation, if you look at language only from the viewpoint of the transmitted, the information, the message, is something which gives rise to the very medium, the immediacy of translatability as such. So, if all the different unique modes of generating meaning in a language together form the medium of translatability, nothing is ever lost in translation. Rather, every language is one piece, so to speak, one complementary element of this, let's call it medium, which he calls Übersetzbarkeit, translatability. Translatability is a medium that is basically composed of, made of, a composite of singular modes of generating meaning in language. So this is before any empirical language can be empirically translated, and before any empirical person can say, something got lost in the translation. So this is their whole argument. It's really inverted if you think in terms of what would be a common understanding of translation. So again, singularity, uniqueness, gives rise to any articulation in language or any work of art, any work of literature's universal translatability. Again, translatability is not the empirical translation that has been done by someone, but it's the very medium, the immediacy of translation. And now, with this, I will go to the second slide. So, of course, now you will say, okay, thanks that you have said something about translatability in the medium of language and not looking at the content and what is being imparted. And now you make a very petty comment on a wrong translation, which is precisely focusing on the content and information. But I have to do this. You see, translation is a mode. It's not a mode, it's a form. And that's what the German says.
And also, like, maybe we should add that it exists two different English translations of this essay done by the same translator. And in the first one says translation is a mode, although the original German is form. But then I think he rethinks it, and then he changes, and then his translation is form in the second one.
Yes. But why is it a form, and why a form is actually important? One could argue, why not mode? With Benjamin's theory of translation, we have just learned that he actually uses this theory of translation to give a justification for the freedom of translation. Because if there are all different modes of generating meaning, they complement each other as translation. So it's not the literal rendering of one word. It's more about producing different modes. So with all linguistic translations of form, we would get probably the integral meaning of it. That would be the argument. However, actually here it's just the wrong word, because form Benjamin, we should keep in mind, he started from neo-Kantian. So form in the Kantian universe is here a transcendental form. It's a form before any empirical translation has been taking place. So that's why it's very important to see translation is a form. It is transcendental. Languages are in kinship, in verwandtschaft, in interrelation before any translation has been taken place. That's why they share the same origin. That's why there is the list in Benjamin, what he repeats from the Bible. Language as such has been given as Adamitic name language to humans by God. They share the same origin. Of course, then the vulgar theological narrative has it with the expiration out of paradise, the fall into history, the original divine language was broken into pieces, into barbaric confusion of language. And now we all have these pieces, every language is one piece of that, a fragment. And now the messianic task would be to bring them all together and to restitute divine name language, or what he calls here in the essay pure language. Yeah, and then you have basically paradise or messianic world regained in linguistic terms. Why that is not so, and why Benjamin basically uses this myth against the myth's intention, will be the end of my introduction, when we will use Haldeman's very good close reading, which also works against the translation of Harrison. But we will come to this maybe in 5 to 10 minutes. So, again, translation, of course, is a, first of all, a relation. It's a relation of two languages or two works, whatever, or you can say two texts. Let's not overstress the work of art or work concept. Not against Peter Bürger, but let's put it two texts. Two texts in a language, in different languages, and they stand in a relation. But yet this relation is basically constituted, or that this relation is possible, is only possible under the precondition that there is a medium for this relation. It's nothing new what I say at this moment. Two texts, there is a relation, and there must be a medium between the two. So nothing added to common common sense at this stage. So two texts and there is a medium. Before I have said, medium and Benjamin is not what is in between. It's not an empirical interspace. So if he says translation is a form, then he says that the very relation between the two is something which is a form, immediacy or translatability, which is before these two languages can stand in a relation. So in other words, the form, translation as a form, is the condition, the condition of possibility of having a place, a position of two languages or two texts which can stand in an empirical relation. It's the very medium of it. This is why I said medium is not defined as an interspace, defined vis-a-vis two entities which are opposed. Rather, the immediacy is before and allows for the position of the two texts. The two texts are already, as the two speakers or whatever, are already in language. So these are the two things to be understood when Benjamin says translation is a relation and translation is a form. The form is transcendental. And it has a lot of consequences for his entire theory of his entire philosophy, basically, that basically what in Kant is transcendental subjectivity, the very form that gives that can give for a subject objective knowledge, which in Kant transcendentality is basically how our very subjective mode of cognition gives rise to objectivity. Is this famous Copernican term. Here, transcendentality is not the subject, not an empirical subject, but language. We're already in language. So, language is the transcendental medium for any knowledge in language, for cognition, for objectivity. And as such, it is before any empirical translation has been taking place. I will just read out the second part that I have highlighted. It should be pointed out that certain correlative concepts retain their meaning and possibly their foremost significance if they are referred exclusively to language. If they are, but pointed out that they are, if they are not referred exclusively to language. Is that really wrong? It should be no, that cannot be. It should be pointed out that certain correlative concepts retain their meaning and possibly their foremost significance if they are. If they are not referred exclusively to man. I forgot this when I did this the first time. Okay, good that I read it out. Actually, sometimes you just think you already saw it. The idea, two things have to be said.
Correlative. There's a slip there. There's a slip in the text.
Yeah, it's a major slip.
Interesting. What is it? What is it?
There are two slips. It should be a negation.
Yeah. Benjamin wants to say that certain Relationsbegriffe, you see already a common misunderstanding when it comes to Kantian terminology. Correlative concepts are not Relationsbegriffe. This is the first thing. Those who are familiar with speculative realism and Miyasu's argument against this allegedly correlationist argument in Kant will know what that means. I will just say, correlation is a relation between two entities. What we have just ruled out before, the medium as interspace between two. A relation is something, as a medium, which constitutes in the first place the very position, the condition of possibility of having two entities in the medium.
Isn't it like close also like to ideas of like differential calculus?
Yes.
And
it is basically,
or like it's also very present in structuralism.
It is in structuralism, in differential, in different concepts of difference.
It's like difference itself. And
difference itself without, you can, as a handy definition, I would always say, relation in the radical Kantian, also Hegelian sense, means you have a relation prior to any relator, to anything which is related.
Yeah.
The argument I have done before, I have said, there is translatability, before we have empirical content to be translated. That's why we shall not say correlative, but relative. Relative means the relation itself constitutes what can be related. A correlation, rather, would be a kind of a constellation, a relation between already established entities, already established speeches, texts, languages. This is the first flaw, but that you can still excuse for not so interested in philosophy, but the other one with the non is actually a bit crazy. It should be pointed out that certain relative concepts or concepts of relationality retain their meaning and possibly their foremost significance if they are not referred exclusively to man. This is again the same argument as before. In the center of language is not the human, not the anthropos. Relate.
So, excuse me. Do you remember the German phrase?
Yes, actually, it's on my computer. But thanks to my smartphone, which is a very old smartphone,
because as a translator myself, from the technical point of view, I imagine that the translation retain. What it is in German might substitute for the missing not.
It could be in this direction, but actually I would say if you have such a strong noun, you should really render it as a noun. But that's
because if retain means hold back, I might be not sure about the.
Yeah, it's true. It hold back.
Retain would be the keep.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So they don't reveal.
I mean, it's really saying the opposite of what the.
Let me give you the German for those who speak German, understand it. We'll also do a rough translation. So, Benjamin refers to what he the theory of translation that he wants to argue against. So even hinweis darauf hinzuweisen, dass gewisse Relationsbegriffe, certain concepts of relationality, ihren guten, ja vielleicht besten Sinn behalten, keep, retain, wenn sie nicht von vornherein ausschließlich, exclusively, auf den Menschen bezogen werden. I think we listen on here.
There's an issue.
Yeah. So, again, this gives actually, it's a very good, you can see also that Benjamin, the whole text is written against common sense. We have already said it's not correlation. Correlation would actually say there are already established rules, texts, languages, work of arts that can be correlated. Benjamin wanted to say that we have a relation, a relationality, before and ahead of any empirical content that has been spoken. So, the best sense, the best meaning, the real significance of this concept of relationality, of relation, is if these concepts are not directly, immediately related to the human. As if the humans would stand in the center of all relations of language. No, rather, language, we call it kinship, Verwandtschaft of all languages, relate to themselves. They relate to themselves, and we take part in it. We take part in an impartibility of language. This is why this is prior. This is why translation is a form. It's prior to any empirical relata, before anything can be empirically related within language. So you see, you have certain concepts of relationality which have their best meaning when they're not related immediately to the human. Because, again, as Benjamin's speculative term goes, human is the animal language has been given to. We are not the originator, not the authors of language. That is why we have language as such and the language of human. And there are also other languages, of course. Languages of things, of animals, and so on. They're all in the medium of language, and they can only be differentiated through, like density, like the density of what they can produce as a meaning in the language. But this is another argument I will omit at this point. But again, this is a very important point. I have read this so many times, and I always added the not in my head, because it's, in German it's clear. yeah, that's what I can also learn about this translation. So, there is in the translation a kind of a constant misunderstanding what the real argument of the text is. The text is to make us understood a relation without relata prior to any empirical translation. So,
excuse me.
Yes,
so
sure.
In that sense, the correlativity would be actually relativity. So there's another step.
Yes, this I mentioned before. This was my kind of strange detour from Meyer Sue and the misreading of Kant. In Kant, there is no correlation. There is nothing to be correlated. There is the definition, the philosophical unfolding of what a relation is prior to anything which can be related. Think of a relation is one of the key concepts of post-Kantian Kantian thought. A relation is something which stands before the relator. Once you have the relation, in Benjaminian terms, the immediacy, the ability, the translatability in language, this is the relation. This is why it's a form. And then after, you have a content. A relation that can be a positions text, which can be interrelated, correlated, and so on. This is the meaning of co-relations.
So it's kind of anti-materialist in a way.
Of course, of course. And also, you see, if you have the misunderstanding with the correlationist, then the other one, the omission of the not, makes suddenly sense. Once you are already on the wrong track here, the second argument, of course, you shoot your leg, of course. It's not by coincidence, but actually, one must have seen this before, but just look at the next sentence. One might, for example, speak of an unforgettable life or moment, even if all men had forgotten it. Yeah, precisely because the relational concept is not being intended to be exclusively meaningful for humans. So there is a work of art that has been never translated and no one has ever heard it. But still, it's unforgettable.
because it has its own linguistic historicality or historicity in the medium of language as a form, prior to any empirical, you know, translation that has been produced. Then again, we can also give a full meaning to what it means that Benjamin says that certain work of arts, certain texts, are inherently translatable, as their basically essential predicate. The translatability of work of arts is not, which empirically can be added to them, they are already before translatable. So it is an essential predicate, so to speak, to be translatable. And now he has to define what let's use a more neutral term, what texts, in whatever language, what texts have the highest likability, or which only already demand their translation. These are those which have the highest linguistic density. And density is the highest, let's say, relation, or let's say the closest way of bringing the mediated or the imparted, the content, close to what is being, to the medium of impartability, to what is the medium. So where medium, linguistic medium, and content come closest, almost to the degree that these words don't mean anything because they don't denote anything else than their very immediacy, when they come closest, then they have the highest density, and the highest density of linguistics being, so to speak, makes them the most translatable ones. Of course, the highest density of language is the word of God, which means nothing to us by definition, because there the medium, translatability, the linguistic meaning, and what is being meant by it, the message, is the same. This is why he says the holy text is the model, the paradigm of any translation, because this text is immediately, without any translation, already translatable, because it doesn't mean anything. So that's why God's word cannot, has to be translated, so there cannot be an immediacy of God's word. This is the anti-mysticist stance of Benjamin. So, in a way, you can say humans, this is still a slightly anthropocentric hierarchy of language that still Benjamin upholds. Humans have, as a phonetic language, the highest density of making clear, of bringing as close as possible the imparted and the medium of impartability. And then there are lower, looser, let's say, less dense layers of language, up to the mute language of things. Animals are in between. So the most inherently, they're all inherently translatable, but the highest translatability is the closest they get actually to say nothing. Nothing else than what they mediate in their very medium. This is a very, again, tautological argument almost. This is why Benjamin says in the early language essay, nothing is ever mediated or imparted through language as an instrumental tool, but only in language. Because what he calls mental being, what is being transferred, is this ontologically the same of what is the linguistic medium. What is the medium of translatability, linguistic meaning, medium, which ahead of any translation guarantees any translation, any linguistic expression. So it's a very difficult theory where you have basically the linguistic being and mental being, or form and content, or signifier and signified, more technical, if they are ontologically the same, they're only seen from our perspective as different sides of the same, then he can say nothing is ever transmitted through language, but only in language. Because it is basically as close as you can get to their very ontological identity. Yet for us, humans, this identity can never be spoken.
Because if you could so, you would have a divine language. Then you would have pure language, the language which doesn't, which only means itself, which only denotes itself. Then we could not transfer any meaning. Then we would have meaningless, would be a nichtssagende, a nothing saying, a nothing speaking language. It would just speak its own very immediacy, which is of course an empty language, or an integral language of everything. So it's exactly the point of indifference where saying everything and nothing is the same. This would be divine language. So, but this is in the back of it. So this, as a technical definition, pure language would be another word to understand what is the medium of translatability, of this very form which is ahead of any empirical text, any empirical translation. This is pure language. And Benjamin's wager is, so to speak, that he says, in every translation, this part, this layer, which you cannot see, which you cannot understand because it's no content, but this layer of language, it's very medium through which it can be transmitted, through which it can be imparted in history, its afterlife, so to speak. This layer of language, the highest density of language, which is crystalline, transparent, so to speak, is exposed or shown, liberated, freed in the very act of translation. Of course it is, because language has to, at least, to suppose that there is some medium through which you can do the transformation from one language into the other. But again, it is not a medium that has been invented after you have two languages, and then you think, oh, how we can bridge this gap somehow, okay, something gets lost in translation. Well, the act of translation just stages or shows, presents the very medium that these two languages share in the first place. What we have called language as or a translation as a form or a relation prior to any relata. So this would be the entire argument of the essay, but of course we have no time now anymore, but now we would go into the tricky parts of this argument.
Can I ask just...
Yeah, sure, sure.
Isn't it a bit, it's kind of, it jumps from one, the idea of transcendental body, let's say, it's almost like parallel, no? The idea of having a medium, or something that it's...
Yeah, it is, like, it is, I mean...
Body, but it's also at the same time prior and transcendental.
It's interesting that you
because
say...
Because form, it's also tricky, right?
Yeah,
when
yeah,
you
yeah.
compare it to content and form,
absolutely.
Form becomes body. And
put it this way. Linguistic mediacy, the medium of translatability in history, that is why we have history, because we have the medium of language. This very medium itself is not a body. It's not an entity, but it's the structure condition, quasi-transcendental condition of any content, any bodies in it, any texts, any definable entities in language which could be correlated. Then they can be correlated. But we talk about the relation prior to this. But, of course, Benjamin employs a very problematic metaphor in the end, the so-called vessel of language which is broken, and that looks like a body, that looks like a real empirical entity. And actually my proposition at this stage would be just jump to this, then we can wrap up there and then we can open the floor. Because I saw.
Yeah, it's
okay. Yeah, yeah. But also, we started a bit later. Yeah, so we can do a bit over time. okay, then my old pedagogical try to go with you through all the slides will not work. Then you have to press a couple of times but until we reach the famous part. If, however, these languages continue to grow in this manner until the end of their time, Benjamin writes, until the messianic end of their history, it is translation which catches fire on the eternal life of the works and the perpetual renewal of language. So the idea was that every language every process of, or every empirical act of translation exposes this, let's say, crystalline, impossible layer, which has no body, but is a form, the layer of pure language. So every language and every utterance in a language is a mode of meaning. All modes of meaning integral, all languages, all utterances in all history together, form together the entire crystalline layer, let's put it this way, because it's not a body, it's like a Möbius strip basically, the crystalline layer of pure language. And they do so in empirical history. So they grow, language grows. With every act of translation, linguistic being is being enriched. So every mode of translation, every mode of meaning, of producing a meaning in the language, what I do now in English, or do later in German, or in any other language, in all history together, all these modes, in one language, in one dialect, with one accent, and also universally, among all languages together, in all history, all linguistic historicity together, all these modes, they form pure language. That's why Benjamin says they are complementary. But what is the entity of pure language in the end? We will do this in a second. But Benjamin says they are growing. With every, if you look at, let's change the perspective, not the total perspective, of all languages relate to each other in a complementary way, all modes of producing meaning. Let's look at one single work of art, or one text that is being translated. Believing what I said in the beginning, other than its empirical being when it's being produced by an author, or what human affairs would be called bare life, the physicality of my presence, which can be governed and so on. All what is the living will only come to the fore in the very unfolding of translation. So what is essential, so to speak, the translatability, the linguistic being of a word, will only come to the fore once it is basically dead, or the author is dead, and the text has been translated. So the afterlife basically is something, it's not a teleological unfolding of what has been there before, but it's basically a kind of testimony, bearing witness to what is in the work of art, other than its pure materiality, other what is its graphic meaning in the moment when it has been produced. It's not an esoteric meaning, but it's basically something only in the translatability. So we have two movements of growing. One is the growing of language through all modes, different ways of producing meaning in a language. All, like the impossible perspective of God, all of them put together would be pure language. And then we have the particular perspective of one work of art or one text being translated and enriched with meaning, with modes of producing meaning in different languages through the very afterlife in translation. So basically, translatability enriched.
But because it's also like very interesting that like from this perspective you see like a sort of like equivalence of the work of history and of translation, because somehow like it acts like even in the same language it changes and grows over time, even though you don't translate it, like
exactly.
there's a change that is history hence translation,
yes.
and it's this progression,
yes.
That it's going to.
And it's also a counterintuitive move to say that work of arts have a history independent of the humans who have produced that. The text has a history. So everything that has been produced in language, every utterance, every expression has a history. And this is the very concept of history. Once you have no history anymore, you have no language, you have no translatability.
Yeah.
We are actually very close in our age to that. This will be our political discussion later, maybe. But yeah, if you have communication and no exposition or staging of the medium itself, everything is communication instrumental, you have no history. By definition, you take this seriously, you cut off the afterlife of texts. Because you have no medium, you destroy and obstruct the afterlife of the very medium. So the enrichment with meaning means, as we said before, layers, the density of linguistic historicality is enhanced. So how can a work of art become denser? Like, denser just means the medium of impartibility, and what is being mediated, signified the meaning and so on, get closer and closer and closer and closer. This basically also anti-intuitively. The heavier, the denser it gets, the more crystalline it becomes. Then you can almost look through, and if you can look through as a crystal, of course no meaning there anymore. Then it would be, the last one would be, the last stage is pure language, then you can look through it. This is the highest density, so to speak, the uranium of language, the highest density, but then it doesn't denote anything, it has no meaning. You need a minimal, you know, a minimal mismatch. Otherwise, we have no meaning.
Yeah,
then you look through. Then you.
Like
course,
the, end, the end of history is the end of translation.
Of course.
But there's no translation.
And this is why he says, however, these languages, and also we have to, in brackets, all work of arts, all texts in empirical languages, and in languages which have not been invented, maybe, but also all dead languages altogether, continue to grow in this manner until the end, until the messianic end of their history. So, and then of course, this is pure language again. But it is translation which catches fire on the internal of the eternal life of the works and the perpetual renewal of language. So, it is this movement, which is, you can say, symptomatically presented by every work of translation, this growing towards the messianic end of language. However, the messianic end of language we do not empirically experience. So, it, this is basically the. It's a kind of sticky,
yeah.
Or is it just a
deal?
So, this was intermediate stage to go to the last point that I wanted to make, and then we. Open the discussion. Sorry, again, I need, I think, two more slides from here. Of course, sorry, one more before. One sentence only. For the great motive of integrating many tongues, languages, into one true language is at work. That is the task of the translator, in brief. This is the great motive. That's how. It's not the one I wanted, it comes after that. But just one more time. Integrating different tongues means different modes of making meaning in a language. Integrating them, making them denser, so to speak, getting closer, in quotation mark, getting closer to pure language, what he calls to the one true language, is exactly what is at work in language. This is the task of the translator. That's why it's a task. You can say an infinite task, no? You will never arrive at it. So now comes the slide that I wanted after this one. Yeah. So now this is the dangerous metaphor that Benjamin makes, and also why people could think pure language, or what I have said, the medium of translatability, the mediacy of language, the linguistic medium of any utterance in a language, could be a body or an entity or something. He now comes with a Kabbalistic metaphor to try to allude to how all these languages and all these texts in languages interrelate, and how they form the entire body, in quotation marks, of language. So there is a parallel text of this would be, there is a Kabbalistic list. Benjamin refers to it, takes it, but of course, as always, when he uses theology as an allusion, as to make something clearer, he displaces it. He distorts, basically, the continuous meaning, the known meaning of theology. So you cannot say this is a one-to-one transmission, or let's say a kind of a theological structure employed in a linguistic realm. It's not one-to-one. So we will see how Benjamin departs from the theological myth. The myth, just in brief, is in Lurianic Kabbalah. That is a text basically Benjamin's close friend Gershom Scholem has written along devoted a long study. There is the idea that the creation of the universe, of humanity and history, happens in the self-contraction of God into a void. Not a void, actually. It's kind of a minus vacuum, so to speak. A contraction of God in the beginning, and the, so to speak, explosion of this self-contraction of God into the universe gives us time, space, and everything in human history. In the moment when this self-contraction of God into an infinite atom or molecule happens, where all everything is dense, everything is together, and the universe explodes, so to speak, vessels where the divine light are being stored break. And so the profane matter of the universe is now mingled with, or is kind of polluted with, so to speak, with divine light. Divine light was contained in some vessels in the beginning, and they, in the breaking of the universe, these, I think it's 288 splinters, are mingled in the material world, in the universe. And now for the Kabbalistic, messianic, just human, the only thing is to repair the world, tikkun, repairing the world, is very materialistic, no believing anything, just to go and pick up the 288 splinters of messianic light, so to speak, and bring them together. That's it. This is, of course, the very powerful myth in the back of, because it uses the same words. So let me read this again. So, fragments of a vessel which are being glued together must match one another in the smallest details, although they need not be like one another. In the same way, a translation, instead of resembling the meaning of the original, must lovingly and in detail incorporate the original's mode of signification, modes of meaning, I said before, modes of signification, thus making both the original and the translation recognizable as fragments of a greater language, just as fragments are part of a vessel. Of course, you can think of bringing all the languages and all texts and languages together could actually reconstitute the divine light from here, the Kabbalistic list, or the original language in which God created the world. Logos was in the beginning, like the word was in the beginning, the creative word, would, like paradise regained, divine language regained, and pure language or divine language would be a body like a thing, huh? Like a vessel, something like that. Many problems with this. Of course, Benjamin has really gives a meaning to this metaphor, which is completely against the intention or the direction of the very metaphor. Thanks to Paul Demand, we have a very good reading of this. Passage. Maybe the next slide, please. Oh yeah, that's the German. That's the German, and I will basically summarize Paul Demand's point, and then we can stop here. Yeah, we cannot read this. Maybe we can. We go one slide back.
What text is that from, Sami?
It's still the same text.
The Poleman. Sorry, this is from a text, a kind of a speech. I think it would be in what was the Rahama also taught in Baltimore. What's the university again? Johns Hopkins.
Yeah, Johns Hopkins.
I think so. Yeah, he gives a speech. Casually in 81, blah blah blah. It was then an anthology of all these speeches. And what he basically says is, first of all, it's a mistranslation. There are no fragments to be glued together. There is no original vessel. Language and all modes of signification in language and all texts, which can be shared and translated in the linguistic meaning of language, are originally. A fragment, or originally fragmentary. So we have the idea of an original fragment without a pre-existing unity. This is the whole point. And to understand that there is no unity before, and yet there are fragments,
and to basically not glue together, but to follow each splinter. You know, you have to think of a piece of language as a splinter. A splinter is always singular. There are no identical splinters. And what you do is not you glue them together, but you follow with your finger the edge of it, so that you can grasp the shape, the singularity of the very shape. And this is what you do. You, like fragments of a vessel follow each other. They're not being glued together. They follow each other like in a metonymical chain, not a metaphor, a totality that is being produced. It's basically you follow the very unique shape, the singularity. What I said in the beginning, the starting point of translatability is the very singularity, that which you cannot translate. This is the starting point of translatability. So you follow this with your fingers, so to speak, just to keep the metaphor of the splinters. And in this way, you render them, you make them visible as a fragment of a vessel. But there is no vessel. The vessel is only a kind of an arrow towards the messianic end of all linguistic history. Like, the task of the translator participates in the integrating, the enrichment of linguistic historicity through the work of translation. This is what is meant here. So you have an original fragment without prior unity, yet to make the singularity of the language visible in the task of the translation, exposing the medium of translatability is taking part in the messianic and integrating and enriching and making denser language towards the direction of the messianic end of language. So this is their quite counterintuitive view of Benjamin doesn't say glue. They follow each other. In their very, you know, like splinters follow each other. If they put them together, you see how they have a singular shape. So maybe it's a good point to stop here. I think there are some questions probably. Yeah, thanks for your attention at this stage. Let's. Shall we have a break? I mean, I have all the slides there for actually real close reading. This was like in post close reading. I think that's we didn't do what I actually wanted, but.
I'm thinking about like the idea of, like, of foreignness, and like, because in the previous weeks, months, like, we had some emails about that, and how like the idea that translation is this like transcendental form of difference kind of allows us to understand how language is like foreign to us in a way, or that we are foreign to ourselves. And I think it's a beautiful way also like to counteract somehow like the violence of language, just this kind of colonizing power towards life, towards other people.
But what do you say? I mean, I would really be precise here. What is the colonizing power of language? I would rather argue the opposite. To familiarize the strangeness of language is precisely what the colonial power does. This is enforced translation.
Yeah, exactly.
Enforced translation without translatability. So basically to make the point on the transcendental kinship, Verwandtschaft of languages, is basically be faithful to the very strangeness, the singular untranslatability, the incommensurability of languages. So in a way, we have a coupling of a transcendental kinship and empirical singularity. And you could say, in today's theory of language, and all what communication means today, in internet, digital age, third industrial revolution, it's exactly the opposite. We have basically transcendental singularity, something that's being always lost in translation, but we can assimilate them through Google Translate or whatever. Maybe exactly the other way around. Benjamin says transcendental kinship. This is the translation as form, gives rise to empirical singularity, to strangeness of language. They are utterly strange to each other. And the common sense says that they are strange to each other, and we have to assimilate them. This would be the common...
Yeah, but this is what is shared in every language, that they are different.
Exactly. Huh? Yeah, but this is not just a language game. They share that they are different. Everybody is different, so they are all the same. No, it's really the idea of this linguistic medium as pure language, which they share. And actually, they share it with the direction towards the messianic unity as originally fragment, originally broken, without prior unity. And this is a bit different than we're all different and that's what we share. So it is really against the grain of all theories of translation today, and also against any theory of communication, of course. Mm-hmm. And basically, exactly the opposite of Google Translate, of every way of half translation, or what is basically the position of language today. It's all against that. So you can even radicalize that. Today's linguistic politics aims at obstructing and colonizing what Benjamin has called the living, mm-hmm. as distinct from bare life, the supernatural, supraphysical entity of what lives on, überleben, survives the work of art, my empirical existence, or in short, history, to extinguish history, which only is something which bears witness to the living. This is all related to communication. So then you can say, of course, what kind of politics you can do in that? If you follow this pattern of translation, nothing. Because already everything is lost, because you have no living. Living is being obstructed by communication. And with communication, you have no history. There's this beautiful essay, actually, just appeared last month, I think, or 2 months ago. Fred Jameson in New Left Review, The Aesthetics of Singularity. It's precisely this point. No historicity, only singularity. But singularity, so to speak, as transcendental. Not kinship as transcendental, but singularity as transcendental. So everything is a one-off thing. There is no historicality. Of course, it's my reading, vis-à-vis Benjamin, but this text should be read as a paratext, basically, of Benjamin's The Task of the Translator. So, living only with transcendental kinship and no assimilation. So the foreignness of language should come to the fore in the very task of the translation.
But I'm sorry, but don't you think that, for example, Google Translate would have you tied into what you get if you more or less master the two languages is precisely a very strange thing. So it points out the intranslatability or the immediacy of language.
But
could you develop a little bit more on the ideological background of of Google Translate that you were polemicizing against? I don't really get it.
Google is not an ideology, first of all. Google Translation, or all these digital technologies, are not superstructure. They are infrastructure of production. That's the first thing. So they are not superstructure, but infrastructure. It's very important. Language is also not superstructure, it's infrastructure. So, insofar, you can say, symptomatically, we can have a clue of why languages are actually strange. And you can say, in the mismatch of two languages, you can see it's kind of strange what they produce. But what they do is they create the fantasy of actually that you could assimilate two singularities which are untranslatable, but you could assimilate or approximate them. Of course, you could have a better algorithm than Google Translate, and many translators, sometimes they do the same, admittedly. You start with a translation of Google, and then you fix it a bit until you think it's a good match. Huh? So, it's basically the idea of transcendental singularity, untranslatability, and then you, with the help of some algorithm and some knowledge and so on, some people school English or school French, you get there. You will not get fully, but there is some loss in translation, blah, blah, blah. This is the common sense idea. Benjamin says the opposite. He says there's transcendental kinship, and to be faithful to this kinship is to expose the very singularity, the real strangeness of that. Because a good translation is actually nothing else than the presentation, the darstellung, the staging of the singularity, not only to languages, but also to texts. So this is why the starting point of the translation is the untranslatability. Or untranslatability as irreducible singularity gives rise to universal translatability, not the other way around. This is not translation as a formative.
Yeah, but it's still a practice, and the whole thing of Benjamin's text is that it's not on a specific practice of translation. It's on the theoretical, it's a theoretical meditation or whatever on what's going on in the process of translation, not in the concrete realization of a translation. And I think that you could.
What is the difference? I would really press you on this. What is the difference? What is the theory other saying? What is then what's going on in an actual translation?
His text, you mean? Well, I would say he's abstracting from any empirical act of translation or any practice of translation towards, as you very beautifully explained, to a transcendental meaning of what's going on in the translation.
No.
So it's...
No. This is not how transcendental arguments work. The transcendental argument is before any empirical. You know, this thing is not... Here's an empirics on practice, and on the same time there's some abstraction from praxis into a theory. This is not how they relate. This is precisely not how they relate. They're on different levels. So, what you demand is a justified claim, but this is not what the text does. But this has its value in itself. So I totally agree to your point, but the other one is an argument on a different level. Because a transcendental argument is never on content, it's before content. So it is basically a retroactive, you can say, refiguration, what has been done in the very practice of doing something empirically. You see, it's not an abstraction from an actually existing a translation. Then it would be just an abstract theory of a concrete content. It's exactly the other way around. In the very act of translation, many abstract notions or concepts are at work. They work there already. And what he gives is the concrete forms which are there in the first place. This is a different way of... it goes against the grain of what we think is concrete and practical and abstract in theory. Here the predicates have changed. The theory is concrete and the practice is abstract. In Google beautifully exposed in the algorithm, which are quite abstract. Concrete, yes, but...
Are you finished? Because I want to propose something.
We will go back to this, because this is the whole point of the entire essay. But
I was just thinking while listening to this, and thank you a lot for this reading, which was very, very enlightening in many ways. If there's possible, imaginable shadow of this text, which would be the task, and I could allude to the German double meaning as well, of the language speaker in a way. Because in this succession from original to the afterword, there's a certain tendency that there's certain qualities of the work or the text, whatever, that can only be achieved in a different language. So already in this one language, there are parts that can't be realized in that language, but only because of the existence of other languages. And the translation exactly, there's whole other different things realized. But so on the other side, then, what should be the task of the language speaker to not expect the work to come to him or her or whatever, but to have to go to these territories themselves and to follow the, I don't know, maybe even the, how are they called in English again, the Scherben.
The splinters, basically,
yes.
the fragments of
yes.
the
essence. Yes, to follow the splinters in this way as well as
that. Good, that would be exactly the meaning of not making
you, the center, or the recipient, or the beholder, the center of translation, but rather the singularity of the splinters. So if you say a good translation would be the echo, the reverberation of the singularity of that which is not being translatable in the one language. So what is singular in one language, but it can never come to full expression, like transparent, like medium and mediate becomes the same, which basically is the deadlock, the blind spot in your own language, when you are at the border of your own language. And a good translation mirrors, or the reverberation of this deadlock in this one language is mirrored in the other. Yet the deadlock there is another one, of course. It's very singular other one. So in a way, you have a kind of interrelation or kind of cross reverberations of linguistic deadlocks in two singular languages. So you would rather have like the what makes the splinter so unique, the singularity of it, what is untranslatable into the other is basically the resonance field for giving a translation, which has another, of course, deadlock, another singular shape, which gives basically the echo for this one. And that's how they basically relate to each other. That's why Benjamin said, relational concepts have their best meaning when they are not, in the first place, immediately directed towards human, because then it would be this text and this text, and then to me and I basically are the medium. No, this is the reference. And you, what you do is, you partake in this. Teilhabe is not monopolizing. It's not a habe, it's not a having. It's a partaking into it, participating into it. So something is going on there as an afterlife between these ones. And that's the task of the translator, but also of the speaker. Because you could say, is not every speaking a form of translation or partakes in the movement of language as translation? I would say so, yes.
But there's also, like, I think a very easy, like, example that he provides when he talks about, like, bread, and he says, like, there's food in German and in French, and of course they refer more or less to the same object, but what they mean to the speaker, it's different. Like, these words actually mean different things to each speaker. So, like, brot means something for the Germans, and then sometimes it means something else to the French speaker. And this is also like this way of the mode of signification that we are talking about.
What they mean is the same, but the mode of signification is different.
Yes, that's, yeah.
So basically you have a
no, I mean, okay. What
center.
They mean, like the object they refer to,
yeah,
is the same, but
exactly.
The way of meaning is different.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So the idea, let's have a naive idea of it, that would be modes of, in the center, like the sun in the center, and then you have rays, sun rays around it, and all the rays, like you draw as a child, the rays of sun, all refer to different modes and ways, artem des Meinens, modes of meaning, modes of signification. They all refer to the same center, the brot, the pain, the bread, or brotjes. And the integral of it, all modes of signification, is pure language, of course. That's basically the translatability as such.
Yeah.
But the problem is that you have no linear medium that can actually translate all the modes of meaning into each other. That's not possible. But the medium of translatability before and ahead of every empirical translation between these rays, let's call it rays, is that they together form the integral of pure language. So this is the argument, basically.
Mm-hmm.
I know the metaphor is limited because it's actually not the center and it's the same with the vessel, but just to have a grasp, an immediate grasp of what that might mean. But I think that the most important point is to see the singularity and the reverberation of what is the linguistic deadlock in each language. So this is being mirrored and echoed. So you can also say again, when you're really at home in a language, you come to the border to your own strangeness in language.
Mm-hmm.
And then of course you have the beautiful German word of Unheimlichkeit, strangeness,
kind of uncanniness in your own language, because what is too close, too homish, too heimish, that immediately goes into its opposite, in its indefinite, indeterminate negation, in the un, in the unheimlich. So the unheimlichkeit of language, the uncanniness of language, is precisely an experience of a practice of speaking in your own language. And to translate, and you can even say that this very singular kind of unheimlichkeit, uncanniness you experience in your own language, at the border of your own language, in this liminal space where the signification cannot get hold of, is precisely what is the condition of possibility, of translatability. Yeah, the most, what you cannot translate. But this basically is the, I call it resonance field for the reverberation of the translatability into another language, which, and you can say, it reverberates in the other uncanniness. What you basically translate is uncanniness, from uncanniness to uncanniness. It goes, yeah, it goes from uncanniness to uncanniness. This is what speaks. That is the channel that the languages use to communicate in quotation marks, you can say so. Mm-hmm. And you partake in this, of course, as strangeness. So again, assimilating language through algorithm, or assimilating them as basically all translatable, approximated at least, would to cancel out the uncanniness mm-hmm. of language. Or what would be the living? Yes.
And where stands like a computer program language in this, because it's quite crystalline, I would say. So.
Yeah, I mean, you can go further. You can say computer language. You can say the language of things is today money. Money in financial capitalism is also computerized.
Yeah.
It's basically algorithmically structured.
Yeah, it's like
some machines are automatically.
Yeah.
In derivative trade.
It's what?
Yeah, of course. They have their own language. That's the so-called Warensprache, as Marx says, the commodity mm-hmm. language. And that has also a very interesting grammar. It's basically a kind of a distorted doppelgänger, doppelgänger, so to speak, of the other one, of what Benjamin was aiming at with his concept of translatability. So it would actually be exactly the opposite run. That would be, you can have a full mapping of the medium and the mediated as such in direct signification. That you can basically, or at least retroactively, give the meaning, the full, the proper meaning to everything, to every mode of signification. That is basically, in capitalism of course, what the price does. The commodity is sold by a certain price, the price is always the right price. Mm-hmm. Because retroactively, it is the right price that was, you know, that will also render your singular expenditure of your working force in language, most of, that is why I said language infrastructure, how you produce your work and then sell your work on the market, will render it communicable, translatable, and basically commensurable of same quality, and can be signified, can given be even a price, and that can also be digitally expressed. So there is basically a kind of a formal language, a kind of a pseudo-para language, a kind of a artificial language, which is, you can say, it's even more alive than life. It's not the living, but it's basically the life, bare life on speed, but not the living, of course.
Yes.
Or on crystal mess, I don't know. But it's basically really the idea that you could assimilate them completely, or subsume them into a technical formal language where you can cancel out what is the untranslatability in language. And only one anecdote. Of course, we all know NSA and so on, Snowden documents, and not many people already had the conspiracy theory. Of course, there's Big Brother watching and so on. What is the limit of having all these code words, of having all these buzzwords, like these search words that also the German Secret Service has given to the NSA? it's precisely the untranslatability, the singularity of language. Unfortunately, these formal machines could never really understand what sarcasm is, what irony is, and where actually
now
someone is pointing. No, this was the whole point. They always need someone. If they have a full match and they have really made the decision, of course they can filter out what it is.
I don't think they develop really good
in
this field. Yeah, it's really the question
how
far it goes. And also the same question is, of course, like how far are we very complicated algorithms? I mean,
but this is the point. You can Kritik durch Darstellung, so criticism through presentation, is affirmation and criticism at the same time. The shift, the perspective shift, is something which a machine cannot do. That is in the reader, or in the beholder, or in the political force field that makes the text speak.
If you were to make a machine that's as complex as a brain, basically.
Of course, I mean, this.
Theoretically, it's not impossible.
Of course,
you think that humans are special or something.
I mean, this is the good argument with Blade Runner or with. 2001. I mean, the machine is more human than the human.
Of course. I mean, this is all
possible. Just
I mean, like complicated machines.
No, no, but according to this language theory of Benjamin, these are all valuable languages. And just languages with a lower density.
Yeah,
and you could have a replica with the highest density, I think so.
I mean, there's like a separation then in kind of the idea of maybe there would be like a biological or cultural languages or something, like the language, how you describe it, feels a little bit like a biological language.
No, it's not. It's neither biological nor cultural. Transcendental is another thing. This was the whole point. Other, what do you think, empirical? It's transcendental. It's before and ahead of any empirical knowledge.
Yeah, no, that's
I know, you wanted to say
no,
this.
A very short remark. Because you have put a lot of emphasis on the non-human aspect of language. And just as a hypothesis, I think it's still interesting to contemplate computer language, algorithmic, generated, etc., as a sort of non-human language. Too. So it's not that I find it not that easy actually to discard completely the possibility that computer languages could actually be quite close to pure language.
Mm-hmm.
I
mean,
in the Benjaminian sense,
in the very possibility of translating, because they have the moment you can say the moment computers have history, then they have. They must have pure language, and they have translatability. They can translate themselves, of course, it's more the Terminator idea, you know, when they communicate, humans are idiot machines for them, and of course, no, but of course, this is not ruled out. You cannot discard it immediately, but they need to have history. So, but the tendency we have today would rather be to cancel out historicity. And when you think about what historicity actually is, then you immediately with language and linguistic translatability. So that was Benjamin's argument, that there is only history where there's language, or history is nothing else than Sprachgeschichte. So linguistic...
We can discuss this later, but I think that technically, in fact, the corpuses that I used for computer translations are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So they're putting more and more historical uses of language into the algorithm, and then you could...
Of course, then
we need to discuss what does history mean.
It's not addition. It's not addition. We are here, we are not with a spurious infinity of having n plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, like just more content that can better be managed. That's precisely not what history is, but we'll come back to this point in a second.
I would have thought you would have said just the opposite, that the computer language, the problem with computer language, is that you would have to imagine, for it to conform to Benjaminian conception of language, there would have to be a moment in the code where the code communicates nothing other than the codability. So if you have any experience coding, you know that when you use computer language, you're basically giving commands. Everything you're coding is actually a command to execute something. And that's precisely not the kind of language that Benjamin is describing. So this is, this is my question. So it's something else. So I have to thank you because I just have to tell you, I find that essay, and especially the essay on language is such and language is meant, one of the most difficult, obscure, bizarre things I've ever read about language. And especially because he's using theology in such an idiosyncratic way. So, what, if you can just bear with me, I tried to be short, but if you can bear with me, I was thinking, if I wanted to ask a question sort of adequate to your presentation, so I would like to try to translate what you said a bit in my language. So translation is not just between English and German, but also just between two people speaking English, right? So I would say something like, the normal use of language is I say something with words. That's my normal experience of language. And if I didn't have that experience to some extent, I'd be really crazy. So like right now, I feel myself communicating an idea to you using words. I'm using them instrumentally to make myself understood. And Benjamin would say, and here he's in solidarity with many other thinkers in the 20th century, he would say, humans don't use language to say things, but language speaks.
No.
Language speaks. No, language doesn't speak to them. Language speaks,
no,
period.
True,
it's
true,
not
true.
Transitive.
True. True then, I guess.
Let's just say, language speaks. We don't know. Human beings are not part of the equation yet.
No.
So language speaks. And what does language say? What does language say? The only thing language says, so if you could imagine an impossible moment where it would be like I, but there's no I, right? But if I language spoke, it would say nothing other than its speakability. It would say nothing other than its sayability or translatability. If language could speak, it would say nothing, it would communicate nothing, but it would just speak the very fact of being able to speak, its speakability. So that would be the pure word. And if you remember yesterday, like, Kafka shares the same Jewish mystical background, and I mean, Kafka's dog is saying, we've lost the true word. And the true word would just be the word that says nothing. It just says, there is language. So you have to imagine, there has to be a kind of big bang almost, like an explosion. Like language just explodes, and it just says nothing other than, hey, there's I mean, there can be language. So it's not an evolutionary argument. Okay, so here's where my question is coming from. That essay is so weird, because first you have language of things. I have no idea what that means, but let me try to give a super concrete example, just to be very simple. Like, the chair, this chair, is speaking its supportability to, like, my ass, in a way. It's holding me up, right? It's not saying any words to me, but in a way, this chair is speaking to me right now. Right?
Not to your ass, not to you.
Yeah, it's holding me up. No, it's holding me up. Or you could say, let's be more poetic, like the water speaks its wetness to my lips. Or
yes.
Whatever.
Something like this.
Something
you
like this.
Intention
so things, you know, but there's no words. Now, let me give the example. This is the one part of the story, this is what I want to ask you about. It's just my personal, I don't understand this maybe. Let's say I'm very heavy and I break the chair, you know, I'm too heavy for the chair. So then the chair is also speaking its breakability or whatever. But the chair does not say, hey, you're too fat. You know, the chair doesn't say something like that. Only human beings make judgments. And so this is my question for you. Sorry, it's a little bit off, but I think off topic, but I'm really fascinated. That when you speak about the density, it makes it sound like languages are in a continuum. Right? The animal language is less dense than the human language. But there's something, I mean, you know this very well, there's something in that essay where the judgment enters into the world. Judgment, like, you know, I'm too heavy to sit in this chair, whatever, stupid example, but whatever, just this idea of norms, not just descriptions, but, you know, you should not. And this is very human. If we don't have norms, somehow we don't exist in a human world. And there, my question is, that seems like not a problem of density, because it seems like a real categorical break. And then I think Benjamin says something like, once that judgment enters into the universe, it makes us see nature in a slightly different light, or nature somehow changes. And I'm just curious how you...
Yeah,
I mean, the universal, I think you explained very well that universal translatability, because the reason why... See, tell me if you think this is correct. The reason why you know, all languages are translatable is because fundamentally every language is just saying there's language. Every language equally participates in the miracle of speakability. I don't know how to say it. And therefore all languages are kin, even though they're totally separate. You know, even though they're totally separate. But could you say something about this problem of
first of all,
judgment?
I saw you. I will just bring the answer. There is kind of a firewall in the continuum of language. On the one side, things and animals. Whether this is fair, Derrida would say no, but let's say this on the one side, maybe they have another firewall, whatever. On top, human language, speakable language. So why is human language being spoken in, not through, but in pure language?
Mm-hmm.
Language just speaks itself. Okay, this we understood already. But what makes it human? The voice, the phoneme, of course, and three things, what he calls the downfall, the sin, the original sin of language. Judgment, Urteil, but also the magic, the performance, auto-performative structure of making an argument as a judgment. In court, it immediately becomes a fact,
right.
But also the auto-performativity of the act of a judgment. This magic, this is one part, and the other one would be abstraction, and the third part would be the magic. No, actually, this would be English. I forgot the third one, I have to look it up. It's abstraction, it's the magic of the and it is basically when you can make it, you can make it a tool.
Instrumentality.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, instrumental reason. Horkheimer, Adorno would say. This is one part, then you have the abstraction, like conceptual abstractive abstraction thought, and the other one, which you say, this is the magic of the auto-performative circle, so to speak, of performative the deed, the tat, the action of the judgment itself before any content is being spoken. Sure, but this makes a human language human. This is exactly why it's not pure language. And this is the minimal gap between what is language as such and what is language of man. But even though we have densities, we have the firewall towards those who have not these three. Because animals have no form, like Sünde, Ursünde, like primordial fall or sin in their language. The codability, amazing. This would be exactly my answer to you. The history of language of computers would be they importing. While coding, their own codability. We can talk about this later, maybe, but now, sorry for.
Well, I just had a question because there has been so, a long time since I read it, and of course, super it's complicated, but I was just wondering because it has all these metaphors towards God and talking about the messianism and stuff. If there is another metaphor talking about the source from which languages break. You know, this kind of big bang that you were talking about before. If there is another metaphor than God in his essay.
Yeah.
There is. I don't remember.
This is an important point. You know, God is no metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
God is a structure.
Mm-hmm.
The structure of the non-identity of language. So the non-identity of language or any utterance in human language, as we said, judgment, the magic of judgment, abstraction, and instrumentality. Of course, language, pure language is only being spoken when all these three are there.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't speak itself.
Mm-hmm.
So, having said this, God is just the marker, the structural marker of this very non-identity.
That's how Benjamin poses. He poses it in the text.
No.
That's what you are saying.
The whole point of theology is a corrective insofar as Benjamin deals with the limits of language which he cannot express otherwise. The same function is göttliche Gewalt, divine violence, in the other parallel essay. It's a parallel text, Critique of Violence.
Mm-hmm.
The same there. This is a structure of a non-identity which otherwise would immediately fall under the very three functions of the fall of language, which would be judgment, you know, magic of judgment, abstraction, and instrumentality. And he wants something else which escapes this. And this kind of mark he needs theology for.
Mm-hmm.
Theology is basically just that bears witness with myths and ridiculous content, so to speak. But it has a material, you know, material structural importance to mark this one. What the content is ridiculous, of course. But this would be religion, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The believer.
Yeah.
Theology is not for believers. Theology is about this structural moment. You don't need to call it theology. But theology here is, of course, a monotheistic theology. Of course, you cannot disentangle the whole thing from the myths. There is, of course, content in it, but it's all about the structure. So, in a way, we have to rid ourselves of any metaphorical content that
mm-hmm.
could be transmitted, imparted through Benjamin's text when he refers to the messianic end, or, you know, in the earlier text, divine language. Just follow.
I was thinking how Benjamin described translation, and then it came to my head this sentence of McLuhan, of information is, light is information in its pure state, but also the medium is the message. But all that is related to technology, of course.
Of course, yeah, yeah. No, I always said, when I teach normally this essay, I think, the cheap version in McLuhan. You know, if you want to keep the communicative science paradigm, language is communication, and the technological formalistic sense of language, the first step to understand Benjamin would be, it's what the Canadian guy said. But then the next step would be, okay, but what is the medium? And then, of course, you depart from all this.
Right.
Because if you give full meaning to what the medium is, then you, what just Aaron said, language speaks itself.
Mm-hmm.
This is the medium.
Mm-hmm.
This is the crystalline, so to speak, layer, which is imparted while speaking in the human way with these three functions. And of course, you could say, medium is the message, has a medium. The concept of the medium in Marshall McLuhan is precisely limited to the one of instrumentality.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's a much more empirical, I mean, medium for him is painting or work, but there's an empirical definition of medium.
But this was why I was spent like 10 minutes or 15 minutes only on the term of relation.
Yes.
You know, correlation would be between content, between established positions. But we have a relation without relata. And this is basically the entrance of into the entire text. The entry point is to understand what is a relation prior to correlations between established content. This is the whole point. Then you understand what is translation as a form, and of course you can then say it's a wrong, I don't like the theory, but this would be the entry point, because otherwise, sorry, who was, no? So,
yeah, we can finish, I mean, you can continue. I was just, because when Aaron was saying about the, when human comes in, is it related, sorry to bring the body again, but is it related to the sin of having a body, like, the idea of you cannot reach the pure language, right, when you put human in the equation, because then you have these three things that you just mentioned.
Yeah. Oh, and Benjamin, there is an original sin. That's the point. There was an original sin. You have basically relations of guilt and relationality without original sin. It's very un-Christian in this topic. I think the body would be in very, the body and what the body wants would already be barred by some signifier of language. Yeah. So it's inscribed into language. Whereas the körper, you know, body has two meanings in German. Körper, corporality, the other one is body. Body is normally like more spiritual body, as it is sometimes rendered in the translation. The body is the one that goes with the language and the history. That's it. It's a category of its own, let's say, very unphilosophical philosophy of history, or his concept of history. The Körper is basically something that is exposed, that's the materiality, basically, of their life. It's a category of singularity and individuality, which you cannot divide further. Whereas the body is actually also a shared, collective body, by definition, because it imparts itself, it takes part in language and in history. So body is also collective body. All of Benjamin's later philosophy of technology, think of the work of art essay, it's already rooted in this. You know, technology as a means of its own, non-instrumental, basically the same as language, where the body can be a collective body. All these utopian
theories towards the work of art in reproducibility here again, have their structural root in this. The body is, you know, has two sides to speak. Like body, life, and Körper. And the body as life is on the side of language, of linguistic historicity anyways. But don't think of the body as something to touch, as something, you know, empirical entity. I wanted to give the word actually to Kris. And to